All right, thank you so much for staying with us. It's still sports tonight. And of course, before we went on that break, you listened to Aaron Okwodiri, the first African to play in the quarterfinals of the singles event in table tennis. And we're looking forward to seeing Aaron Okwodiri inspire Team Nigeria in the team event of the Olympic Games as well. Interestingly, we've been drawn on the same side of the draw against China. But impossible is nothing. That's the summary. They have to go out there and fight and see what they can make out of it. And talking about amazing performances at the Olympic Games, let me just quickly tell you the story of this Ethiopian, Almaz Ayana. That's the story of triumph, of excellence. She, today, smashed the world record to win Olympic gold in the women's 10,000 meters event. 24-year-old Ayana shattered the field to finish in 29 minutes, 17.45 seconds, breaking the previous world record by over 14 seconds. Amazing. Kenya's Vivian Cheruiyot improved on the bronze medal she won in 2012, finishing second in 29 minutes, 32.53 seconds. While after winning gold in London 2012, Ethiopia's Tinoruj Dibaba could only finish in third place. But guess what? She ran a personal best time of 29 minutes, 42.56 seconds, but it was only good for bronze. That's how well Almaz Ayana performed, all right, breaking the world record. All right, so Ethiopia will join South Africa, Egypt, Tunisia as the African teams on the medals table. Team Nigeria, I'm sure, will be joining very soon as well. All right, let's talk about America now very quickly. We called him arguably the best Olympian of all time, greatest Olympian of all time. But some will say, okay, let's just limit him to swimming. The greatest swimmer of all time, Michael Phelps, continues the dominance as, and of course, continues to underline the fact that he's indeed one of the greatest Olympians. By winning his fourth successive 200 meters individual medley at the Olympics, Japan Kosuke Ajino won silver. Wang Shun of China took bronze. And so Michael Phelps adding to his tally of gold medals at the Olympic Games. We wish him, congratulate him, and wish him the best of luck. All right, it's time for us to switch gears now. Before we do that, let me just quickly run through for you the Team Nigeria update and tell you a lot of you are asking questions about the Dream Team 6. They have resumed training after the sports minister, Solomon Dalong, ordered the payments of their allowances. The Nigerian Football Federation have also been involved in resolving the impasse. The basketball team, Africa's only representatives at the Olympics, the Tigers, lost their third game in three games. 9 points to Spain, all right? But no shame in losing to the world number two. Nigeria's table tennis team will face China in the opening game, in the opening group game. We talked about that before. And of course, in short put, not good news for Nigeria. Onwuneka Ogwelogu has crashed out, all right? As athletics begins, not on a good note for Nigeria. And then Uhonoma Osazuwa also failed in the women's heptathlon event. All right, so not too many good stories to report around Team Nigeria at the ongoing Rio 2016 Olympics. But it's time for us to come back home now. And tonight, we want to take you back in time. 27 years ago, August 12, 1989, Nigeria against Angola was a World Cup qualifying game at the National Stadium through Lere, Lagos. 10 minutes at the end of the game, Samuel Okparaji, who was playing for the first time inside a member of the National Stadium in Lagos, slumped, and that was the end of it. A passed on 27 years ago. But today, we remember Okparaji, and you can see the hashtag on your screen, hashtag we remember Okparaji, and we want to urge you, we're dedicating tonight's program to the memory of Samuel Sochukwuma Okparaji. As you talk to us on Sports Tonight and interact with us, please include that hashtag, hashtag we remember Okparaji. We will appreciate it. Let's do this in the honor and, of course, the memory of our fallen hero, Samuel Sochukwuma Okparaji. And, of course, before I bring in my special guest, who I'm sure you'd like to meet, let me just read this for you. You can see it on your screen. Okparaji, I mean, this is this quote from Okwaraji's statement to his club when they were asking him to not to come for a call-up to Nigeria. He says, I am a lawyer, you know, and signed to play football for certain conditions, but I don't think that will include reselling my services to my country. You and your club cannot stop me from playing for my country. Let me tell you, I am going to represent my country. That's Samuel Sochukwu Okwaraji speaking to his club that time in Italy. And of course, he played in Germany, he's such a patriot, and it's a pity. It was while playing for Nigeria, against the advice of his club, that Okwaraji slumped and died. And because of that, he got no compensation. The family got no compensation from the club over the death of Samuel Sochukwu Okwaraji. And tonight, I have a special guest in the house who will be talking to us about Samuel Okwaraji and all that happened on that day. I have the pleasure of introducing to you Kunle Solaja, the General Manager, Special Publications of the Sun Publishing Limited, publishers of Sporting Sun as well.
The Daily Sun.
And the Daily Sun.
The Saturday and the Sunday Sun.
And yeah, Kunle Solaja is our guest on Sports Tonight. He's respected sport historian, keeps record, and it's courtesy of Kunle Solaja that we can reproduce to you some of the pictures of that day. That ill-fated game, Nigeria against Angola, 1989, at the National Stadium in Lagos. Kunle, thank you so much for joining us on Sports Tonight.
Thank you very much, Tony. Mm. It's always a pleasure being here.
Yeah, 27 years ago, I'm sure it still feels like yesterday to you.
Of course, it does. If you can also recall that it also happened on the eve of the 10th anniversary of another disaster that happened August 13th. Shooting Stars versus Bendel Insurance.
FA Cup.
When 24 fans died and over 30 injured. So within that period, a lot of tragedy were just woven together.
Tell us about that day. We are going to be showing you pictures. Those pictures are courtesy Going for Goals. That's the book that Kunle Solaja put together. A summary of Nigerian football statistics and the highs, the lows of our game. So I urge you, try and get a copy of that book, Going for Goals. That book is, of course, endorsed by the Nigerian Football Federation. So we got some of the pictures from your book.
Thank
of
you
course,
very much.
Courtesy of your, we got your permission to use them.
Yeah,
and these are the pictures of some of the things that happened on that day. Some fans also lost their life. We'll talk about that later on.
Yeah.
But this was the moment. Okwaraji slumped
yeah.
And never got up. What 10 minutes
actually,
at the end of the game.
Yeah, that's what actually happened was that there was an Angolan that fell, and all attention was on that Angolan player. So a standalone Okwaraji just fell prostrate, face down.
Mm.
So nobody knew what actually happened. And I can recall that day it was Samson Siasa, a member of the squad, that was the closest player to him. So the moment Siasa got to him, tried to raise his face up, and what he saw was probably very frightening. And there and then we knew that something must have gone on. Mm. Because as he just attempted to lift Okwaraji's head up, he raised his hands over his head, and we knew that something bad must have happened. I later spoke with him. I said, what really happened? He said he saw him foaming, gasping for breath, and with his teeth gritty. So he knew that
it was a battle for his life.
It was a battle for his life. And I spoke with one of the doctors that immediately attended to him that day. He said he died fast, possibly before he was evacuated from the pitch.
Mm. That's the story. 27 years ago. Kunle, before I come to you, a lot of people do not even remember that that day was such a terrible day for our sports. Apart from Samuel Okwaraji passing on, some fans also lost their lives to stampede
at the National Stadium.
Yeah. Let me give you the names of those fans. Niyi Moshuro, all right? We're told that 15-year-old schoolboy, probably not a football fan, but was going to the stadium for the first time. Unfortunately, that was also his last time. There was also Shehu Tijani and Okore Agu. These are the only names that you could pick out
from the five
that died.
Yeah. So So what actually happened, that if we can still recall, that was the first match at the National Stadium for over 2 years, because the stadium was shut for renovation in anticipation for hosting of 1991 World Youth Championship. So it was under renovation. So with football, with the national team outside Lagos for almost 2 years, that was the first match and a World Cup qualifier for that matter. So the stadium was open earlier than normal. Around 9 o'clock in the morning, the stadium has been open and people were just rushing to the stadium. I can recall that the stadium, you cannot, if you drop a pin on that day, it will never touch the ground because it will fall on somebody. So the place was jam-packed. Even outside, you have over 2,000 people making round the ramps to see whether they can still have opportunity of going in. So, and at the same time, we must also commend the organizers, because there was announcement blaring on the public address system directing people to move from the northern terrace to the southern terrace, that is the Lagos end of the pitch, where there could be space for them. So in an attempt to do that, and when initially it was just pushing, then strokes, exhaustion, the next thing, deaths. And for the first time, you could see the ambulance
moving around.
The Tata track had just been renovated, so you would not expect vehicle to move over it. But on that day, that protocol had to be broken, because ambulance came to evacuate people first to the medical center
right there inside the national stadium,
which unfortunately had just 3 beds. And then you have over 30 people who were exhausted, so some of them were being treated on the bare floor, and some of them later had to be taken to the general hospital where they were confirmed dead.
Last year, I mean, those are the pictures once again showing on the screen. Last year, the House of Assembly, particularly the Sports Committee, made some recommendations and said they were going to ensure that Okparaji's family don't bear the loss of Samuel Okparaji alone, particularly considering the fact that they got no insurance compensation for the loss of Samuel Okparaji, because he was playing outside of Europe, specified by his club that if you are playing within Europe, if you are playing within our jurisdiction and you have injury or you lose your life, we'll pay compensation. But if you are playing in Africa, our insurance wouldn't cover you. The National Assembly said they were going to do something to make sure that the family of Samuel Okparaji are able to benefit, get some financial reward that they didn't get with the loss of their son. But a year after, we've not heard anything about it. We want to use this opportunity to urge the National Assembly, the Nigerian Football Federation, to please make sure that that is not a promise made in vain. But Kule, as we wrap this up, what would you want us to do? There's a stadium named after Samuel Okparaji in Imo State, but the stadium is as good as a grazing
like
field.
Just talk about the Wunderlawa Stadium in Abeokuta.
Asheru
Stadium.
It's almost non-existent. Almost nothing happens there.
Yeah. As a person, I'm averse to naming stadiums after individuals now, because very soon we will run out of stadiums. But you also know that stadium rights have become good marketing tool all over the world now. So it has become a marketing issue that you don't just name a stadium after somebody. We must also be thinking of benefits, marketing benefits, financial benefits that stadium has. But then, one would still expect that 27 years down the lane, something tangible should be done in memory of Samuel Okparaji. Not just him, because you remember that he's not the only footballer that have died in active service. Before him, there was a player of railway, David Omofaye, popularly called Idi. I think he was the first recorded Nigerian to drop dead at the stadium. That's at Onikan Stadium, the then Lagos, King George V Stadium in 1954. And after Okparaji, we have Amir Angwe, who was playing a continental match for Julius Baja for Nigeria.
Hold it there a little bit. We'll come back to continue from that point, but let's go on a quick break. When we return, we'll just wrap it up on Sports Tonight. So join us again.